morning, everyone.
Professor Ren. I should speak Mandarin or English? Okay, I think you have translation there. Okay. 这个非常欢迎今天所有这个对这个非常重要议题的大家来听今天早。这个也感谢李院长，还有我们的政策中心主任 Professor Ren， 以及这个苏院长、张院长，这个在今天这么早的时刻能够一起来，大家关心这个重要的课题。刚来跟李院长讲，其实这个最近几十年科学进步很快，可是实际上也牺牲了很多社会的共同利益，尤其是这个上面居住的最重要的一份就是人类。那这里面当然有很多的东西其实应该要尽快的讨论。前两天刚好看到 Stephen Hawking 的一个这个演讲，他提到现在不光是科技的进步，人工智慧的这个人文社会的一些想法思想，如果文明不能够尽快的跟上的话，可能会变成另外一个文化的好奇的开始。那当然目前这个我们最切身关切的其实是我们生活周遭的物质环境，而且这个其实问题也不完全是你一个人在家里面把你房间的空气清理干净就结束了，因为你一定要跟人家互动，你要走出来，而且现在其实是国际的时代，不是把台湾弄好就好了，那这个问题就变得非常困难跟重要了。这个需要社会的公民意识能够强烈的学习，才可能这个让所有人真正的重视这个议题。我想今天的讨论会是一个重要的这个讨论，也有希望这样子的一个讨论能够引起更多大家的参与跟回响。我相信今天的活动必然是一个非常成功的活动，而我们的这个社会风险与意识中心是吧？我常常跟我们的主任讲，这个名词太长了，要缩短一点啊。这个将来他们也会推动持续相关的议题的活动，也希望大家能够像今天早上一样踊跃的参加。谢谢大家。
谢谢公司校长介绍。现在请让我们时间交给主持人周主任。
Professor Oliver， 李院长，副校长，苏院长，在场各位贵宾哈，非常高兴哈，大家能够在端午的假期哈，这么一早就到来参与跟关心这样的议题。我们今天报名的人数超过300多人，那我们很早两个礼拜前就 close 报名的人，所以我们有一些参与的同仁现在应该是在另外一个会场哦，在一个视讯的会场。那我们今天非常高兴，我们邀请到国际上非常知名的风险治理哈的一个学者哈 ，Risk Governance Scholar of Risk Governance Internationally， 哦 ，Professor Owen Lam 来给我们一个 keynote speech。那 Professor Owen Lam 他本身是德国 Stuttgart 大学社会系的教授。那他在2011年的时候，因为这个德国总理Merkel 因为福西马的事件，组了一个ESCO Committee of the Safety Energy 的一个就是一个能源伦理委员会。那这个伦理，那 Professor Oppenheim 是其中的一个重要的一个成员。那另外一个德国社会学家Professor Ulbeck 也是另外一个重要的一个成员。那所以他们后来做了一个非常重要的一个决定哈，德国在这样的一个过程里边哈，怎么样如期的去 phase out 他们的 nuclear power。 那我想这个是世界各国都在学习的一个经验，那包括也是我们台湾在学习。那我们中心在
去年的时候，各位可以上网，我们中心在去年的时候有把这一份文件报告把它 translate 成为中文，所以如果各位同仁有兴趣，可以现在就可以上网 去搜寻。好，那 Professor Ovington 另外一个非常重要的资历，也就是我们也正在学习，德国有一个气候变迁委员会，是一个 federal level 的，那就是 Global Climate Change Council。那 Professor Ovington 也是其中一个重要的一个成员。那这个德文叫做 WBG， 就是他们就是德文的一个。那他们其实每一年都会出非常重要的这个政策报告，去引领德国面对无论是气候变迁，无论是能源，无论是空污或是都市，或是整个比如说现在谈在AI。他们这个社会怎么面对这个世界的一个变局？那他们在2011年的时候，是出了一个非常重要的一个文件就叫做 World in Transition 各位上网都可以找得到Social Contract for Sustainability 说一个这样的一个国家面对一个全球的变局，他们怎么样去在一个世界的变局里边，他们怎么样去跟他们的公民，甚至跟欧盟的公民。怎么样去签订一个社会的一个契约那所以这个是一个非常重要的文件。那我们事实上我们中心也在去年也把这样的一个文件translate 出来那它这样一个文件有一个 summary 跟一个全文那我们都有已经把它翻译出来那因为授权的关系德方授权的关系，我们只得到这个 summary 部分的授权那现在因为德方在这个review我们的翻译所以应该很快就会释出给大家好，那因为 Professor Ovington 在这个里边有非常多的贡献我想他今天在他谈气候变迁跟公民参与的时候，也会把这样里边的一个元素加入那 Professor Ovington 另外一个非常重要的一个现实就是他现在是德国 Potsdam 一个这个 International Institute。of the advanced sustainability studies， 三位科学science director 之一的非常重要的一个 director， 所以我想我们今天非常高兴的也非常荣幸的能够请到他来给我们的一个 talk， 那我们这样的一个场次在Professor Ovington 给我们一个 keynote speech 之后，我们也很荣幸请到两个。公民团体的代表来做地谈那第一位是东米的这个胡德勤胡执行长那第二位是绿门大家对绿门都非常熟悉的洪正安副秘书长那待会我们在这样一个 keynote speech 以后，我想我们也经过他们两个的一个对谈，我想我们应该有非常多充分的时间来跟大家交换一下我们的一个经验这样子。好，那时间的关系我们就用最热烈的掌声来欢迎 Professor Ovington。
Well, good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for being here. I'm very delighted.To be the keynote speaker this morning, and I'm also very grateful to the university here, to the sponsors that make this event possible. I think we're talking about a very important topic, and that topic is first about climate change, but secondly, about how to make the transition towards sustainability feasible in the sense of public involvement, public participation, and policy making.And what I would like to do today is basically to talk a little bit about participatory approaches that can help us to make that transition socially compatible and also politically feasible. Let me start out by talking a little bit about the risks that we're facing. And I would like to take a more generic view on risk. And this will also accompany us throughout.The lecture this morning. And there are basically three elements that I would like to emphasize. And these three elements are complexity, uncertainty, and ambiguity. I know that this sounds very abstract, but it is something that unites all the risks that we're facing, be it the climate change risk, be it the air pollution risk, be it mobility and traffic risk, be it natural risks. And these three elements are first, that most of the risks that we're facing today are fairly complex. Complexity means that between a cause and an effect, we have a lot of intervening variables. It's not so easy to assign a specific cause to an effect, but there are a lot of promoters and attenuators between causes and effects, and that makes it necessary for scientists to model these kind of chain of causes and effects. It's not obvious anymore. And that is extremely important for all the environmental risks that we have, specifically those that we don't see and feel. Some of the air pollution we can see and we can feel, but a lot of contaminants, for example, in food, but also a lot of physical risks like radiation. The human senses have no way to detect it. We need scientific instruments to detect it. And very often it's, again, very difficult to see, for example, diseases and to find out what are the causes, are they environmental, are they genetic, are they behavioral, and that is something that scientific modeling needs to do, and where scientific modeling is extremely important to get to the right policies. The second major point is uncertainty. We all know we live in an uncertain world. We don't know what happens tomorrow and the day after tomorrow, but we have to plan for tomorrow, and we have to plan for our kids and our grandchildren. So this is one of the main challenges of humankind in any way, that on one hand side we know about the future, but at the same time the future is uncertain, but we want to design the future. And that's why it's so important that we understand uncertainty, and if we can, to characterize uncertainty. So very often there are boundaries of uncertainty, where things are just speculation. Sometimes it's possible, sometimes it's very probable. And risk analysis is one way to think about uncertainties. And the third big element is ambiguity. And ambiguity is something that you face every day, that even if you agree on the factual outcome of something, it means something different for different people. So if you talk to some people, they say, oh, you know, coal is not that bad. You know, there are other things that are worse, like traffic. And if you talk to the manufacturer of cars, they say, well, you know, we've done a lot to reduce the impact of cars. Look at the coal industry. And if you look to the next person, you say, okay, it's agriculture. You know, we've got a lot of particulate matters that come from agriculture. That's a coal. So you know, the buck is being passed from one to the other. And so there's a lot of ambiguity, the differences in interpretation. And when we talk about transition and the joint program for technology, we need to deal with ambiguity. Because otherwise, you know, we just have one fraction against the next or the third fraction, and now we not get to any kind of consensus. And if you want to have transition, we have to be sure that everybody is part of that transition, that we don't leave people out. That's a very important element, and that's why these three elements are kind of the building blocks of any policy that has to do with risk. Now, when we talk to climate change, which is, you know, major part of my discussion today, you can see that, yes, we have highly complex system here. It is, we have greenhouse gas mixes, and they have different contributions. You know that, for example, methane has around 10, 12 times higher climate change impact than CO2. We have emissions from agriculture. We have emissions from industry. We have emissions from the utility sector, from mobility, all of them contribute. And everybody says, as I said before, that we are only a marginal part. Every country says we are only marginal. But if you add all marginal contribution, it comes up with a very large contribution. So we have behavior sinks under pressure. We're not quite sure about that, how the oceans respond, how the atmosphere responds. And we have a lot of positive and negative modifiers like the clouds. So this is a very complex issue. And one of the things that I would like to point out already in the beginning here, complexity is difficult to communicate. Why?
Well, most people intuitively assign causes to the proximity in location and time. So everything that's near and close by is seen as a cause. And that was very useful when we were coming from the jungle into the savanna around 30,000 years ago, because to be quick in causal attribution was important for survival. Nowadays, we are sometimes tricked into our intuition that something that is close by and close in time must be the cause of something that we suffer. So if somebody has cancer, he asks him or herself, what happened last year that I got cancer? Well, it probably wasn't last year. It was probably 10 years ago. It was something that was far remote. And that's also true for climate change. Now, if in Germany somebody drives a car and I tell them, look, if you drive a car that may have impact on a flood in Bangladesh or in Taiwan, they say, well, be serious. So it's very clear that this kind of complexity is extremely difficult. We can understand it cognitively, but even our heart don't believe. And that's why climate change is still something where people say, I can't believe it. It's just too complex. Secondly, we have a high degree of uncertainty. So how much warning do we expect, specifically if we specify it on various regions? We can do it globally, but on specific regions it's more difficult. The regional distribution of temperature, rainfall, etc. is still a very uncertain element. We have extreme weather conditions that we know that the intensity has increased and is still increasing. We don't know when it comes and where. And we have a lot of interaction with other global changes that we still don't understand very well. It is also very ambiguous. So we have an ongoing, very unproductive battle in the political field where, you know, a lot of people say, well, just invest in mitigation. The others say, no, just invest in adaptation. Well, both is just not very productive. We need both. Well, some of the climate change is happening and we need adaptation, but if we can prevent it from happening, it's probably the most economical way to deal with it. So in that sense, mitigation, adaptation, prevention are all things that we need to do in parallel rather than as a substitute. There will be potential winners and losers. We know that if you go to Siberia, a lot of people say, well, maybe benefactors of this. And other areas also think, well, why don't we get into more climate change? It makes our life easier. So in that sense, yes, there are also winners, and they, of course, are less prepared to do something. There are a lot of trade-offs between economic cost of prevention and mitigation and long-term environmental impacts. The Stern report that I mentioned here was one of the first saying, look, if you don't invest now, it will be much more costly later on. But again, there's a lot of contention about that claim. And there's an issue of social justice and fair distribution. I mean, the European countries and the United States have been the main culprits of putting a lot of CO2 in the air for the last century. Now, of course, China and other countries are really now the main contributors. India are now third. And we'll see that, you know, what is a fair distribution? And that has been one of the major elements of the Paris negotiation as well as in the Copenhagen agreement. And we have the transboundary nature, which also you're probably familiar with the dilemma of the commoner, that you know, everybody wants to be a free rider. So if everybody else is going to do something, I don't have to do it. And that is a very pervasive poison. And we have seen it in many, many negotiations that people say, oh yes, in general, I feel, but you should go first. And if everybody says you should go first, nobody goes. And that's one of the problems that we have when we talk about transboundary risks. Now, we have three kind of models of global governance on climate risks, and we've tried all three of them to some extent. Some of that seems to fail, others seem to work very well. The first main governance model is cooperation of national governments, international governance bodies, So this is kind of that, you know, we try to have a common agreement to overcome the dilemma of the commoners, and a Paris Agreement is probably the best we could get on that issue. So we do have now an international accord. We still don't know very well how to monitor it, how to control it, and specifically compliance management would be a real major problem. And a lot of people say they're going to do something, but they don't. And then, of course, difficult to see what happens if they don't come up with their obligations. So we have global alliances, that's what we more at Paris, but we also have multilateral agreements. So a lot of countries started, for example, in the EU, to have their own goals and they want to have their own policy, regardless what the others would do. But we have also that we have civil society model, global players, including multinational corporations, globally operating NGOs, starting to have joint projects between industry and NGOs, for example. And that is something very promising to see that, or for example, green financing, that a lot of the pension funds all over the world say, we won't invest anymore in coal, or we won't invest anymore in non-sustainable practices. Now, if there's no money in there anymore, then very often these industries have a problem. And in that sense, it is something that is done on the sub-political level. Ulrich Beck, one of the main colleagues of Dr. Cho here, he was had a lot of emphasis on the sub-political level, where you can do a lot of things in terms of actions that will be impossible for governments to enforce. For example, green finance is something the government cannot do itself, but if all the actors in society have money saying, well, we want to invest in a sustainable future, well, then this will have a real major trigger towards a better transition. And the third one, which I will probably go into more deeply because that's part of the interest of this audience here, to have international but also national and global efforts to include deliberative participation as a major input to policy. Now, for an international or global problem, it seems like to be odd to say, well, let's do participation because that's on the citizen level. So how do you get from the citizen level to the global level? But there are two major arguments here. Number one is that if you don't convince your own constituency that this is important, how do you want to have an impact on the global level? So our conviction really is that you have to take the citizens along, and if they are willing to go through that transformation because they feel the goal is worth it, then we have all the power also to go to the global level. If you feel it's only an elite that goes that way, and there's a counter elite that doesn't like it, it's very difficult to be convincing on the international scene. And the second point is we're already starting also with global participation efforts on a global level. WWF had initiated something which they called WWW Climate Change, which is a large citizen participation in 164 countries, almost all countries in the world, that combines citizen participation towards designing measures for climate change mitigation. And that's an effort that is really global. And I think it also shows that beyond boundaries, citizens can, you know, join forces in order to make social changes towards sustainable development. Now, when we talk about this, I think we have to all conclude this into some kind of structure. We call this structural risk governance. And governance is something different from government. Governance really meaning how do we get to collectively binding decisions. You know, we all societies have to develop rules and norms and values that are more or less mandatory for all members. Otherwise, you could not exist as social beings. And the traditional way of thinking about it was that there is a government that has been designed to make collective But now we talk about transitions that have to take everyone into account. It's very important that these big decisions are not just made by governments and then enforced into the populace, but that the members of society are part of the body that generates these rules, these collectively binding decisions. Because any transition also means that you have to go through pain, through cost. It's not for free. Transitions are never for free. And that's an important element. And if it's not for free, you need to make people buy into this transition. That the transformation is a part of their life, not just that somebody else tells them to do that. Then you will have opposition. If people have ownership over their transformation, then they feel they're part of it, and they like to go through it because they see the goal is worth the cost going through that transition, period. So risk governance is very important, and risk governance needs to have a set of characteristics. The first one is that anytime we talk about risk, we talk about two things. One is about the physical risk that we face. If you think about global climate change, yes, we have an increase in temperature that will have an impact on agriculture, will have an impact on climate and extreme weather incidents, it will have an impact on human health. But it's also something, an image that we have about our world. Where do we want to live? What do we want to change the physical world in a way that we've never done before? What is the role of human beings in our transformation of the world? How much nature do we want to preserve? That all question that has nothing to do with just the pure physical world. It's a part of our imagination, of our perceptions. And so it's very important that any time you have a governance system, that that governance system includes both the perceptions, the images, the narratives of the world, and the physical impacts. Both need to be combined, and that's what risk governance tries to do. That's my first point. Both real and perceived dimensions of risk are important. Secondly, risk governance has to be inclusive, and inclusive means participatory. That means we have to include the governments and all their agencies. Secondly, the private sector. They're not just a culprit. They are very important partners in this. We need to make the private sector partner, not an enemy. There's no way we can use. Thirdly, civil society with all the NGOs that are partially represented here, very important. And fourthly, expertise. Not just science, but people who have knowledge. Because if you have high complexity, you need very good scientific models, because very often things are well meant, but they're not good. And if you don't have the right science behind it, we may do a lot of things that are not effective. And the issue is, what we really need is effectiveness. They need to be effective. They need to be efficient. Private sector can deal with that. They need to be resilient, meaning that even if things change, if we have surprises, we need to be able to accommodate, and they need to be socially just. They need to be fair. So these are the four main criteria. That's what I said about available science. The need for anticipating errors virtually, that's something, I think you mentioned it before, that we think about smart cities, smart intelligence, if you made the same point in your introductory speech. Very often, many of these challenges of global climate change, not just global climate change, but also other challenges that we face in a technological world, are not linear anymore. Linear means if you do something wrong, you get immediately the negative consequence. Now, with none of those modern threats, that's not true. They're non-linear, they have a tipping point. What does that mean? You do something wrong, and there is a positive feedback. You put all the coal out there, you get a lot of cheap electricity, nothing happens. If you reach a specific point, suddenly you have an environmental change. And it's just like a switch. Switch on, switch off. And if that switch is on, well, you have all the negative consequences at once, but changing them is extremely difficult. Sometimes not even possible. Irreversible. So you have to change before you see the negative consequences. And that is, again, something against intuition. We learn by trial and error. So if we try something, and then we see, oh, it worked. The whole market economy is trial and error. So we start a company, we build a product, nobody buys it, okay, we go bankrupt. That's error. Then we try another company. That's kind of a market economy. However, in this field here, that's not a good recipe. We have to anticipate the error before it happens. And actually, the physical sciences are very important because they tell us more about that area in which that tipping point could be. And we need to anticipate these consequences and then make sure that we never reach the tipping point. A very classic example is the Gulf Stream, you know, the of water that, you know, from the Arctic comes down, soft water and fairly warm water in the summertime. It's a typical switch-on-switch-off effect. And the Gulf Stream had been switched off three times in the history of, know about it, for the last 10,000 years. So there is already an occasion that that happens if the Earth's atmosphere is warming too much. And it took 300 years for the Gulf Stream to recover. So do we want to wait 300 years? Probably not. So this is something we need to be very sensitive to, that anticipating error is one of the elements there, which is difficult to do. And then we have, and I said that already, risk management, quality, effectiveness, efficiency, resilience, and fairness. Those are the four major criteria. Now, this is a process of risk governance. This is the so-called International Governance Council suggestion. Don't want to go too much deeply into it, but that's kind of how we design the governance structure. And you can see there's the pre-assessment means that we're really looking into how the problem is framed by different people. That's the ambiguity issue again. Because some people frame it this way, other this way. Some people think global climate change is just a big hype. We have to get through it. Other people think it's a major challenge to society. Third people say, well, it's one of the problems that we have, not the biggest one, and so on. And you have to get these people together. You have to know, you know, what is actually the problem? What are you focusing on? Then you appraise the physical impact, but also the concerns of people. Those is very important. As I said, risk is always both. It's a physical element, a consequence, is also social construction. So both of which needs to be intertwined. Then we have to characterize and evaluate these risks. What, you know, is really the impact there? What can we learn from it? And then we have to manage it. So that is how we can make measures against whatever risk we want to attack. Now, how can we manage climate change risk? This is a real issue here. And I would really like to focus on the public input, because that was something that you know, I was asked to do. And you can see, again, this pre-assessment, appraisal, characterization, and management. Most of the formal models of risk management were risk assessment, risk management, risk communication. So first try what is the risk, physical risk, then you look how to reduce the physical risk, and then you tell the public what to do. That model is not very effective. And it's not going to work. If you start communication at the end, well, people would say, well, you just tell us the results. You want to be part of creating these results. That doesn't mean that we just, you know, mix science and common sense. It is that we, when we develop our approaches to climate change policies, we need to include those with all the various frames in order to make it valid on one hand side, but also acceptable. So this is a very important element, validity in terms of societal validity and the acceptability as a part of the consensus within society. So our model is that analysis and deliberation comes at the same time, and they are companions to all the four steps of risk governance. So for communication and deliberation is part of the process, already the pre-assessment, in the appraisal phase, specifically in the characterization evaluation phase, and in the design of the management. So how do we use this? Well, there are two crucial questions that we need to address when we talk about participation. One is inclusion and the other one is closure. Actually, when we talk about any collective decision-making, these two questions are the key and crucial questions.
And when I talk about inclusion, I mean, who makes the decision? Whom do we want to involve? We cannot involve everyone. We cannot have a participatory process where every citizen of Taiwan is part of the decision-making body. Well, that would work, just physically would work. Well, they can vote, but you know, if you have a discussion with everyone, how do we want to do that? So there's always a selection. And the issue is, what is the rule of the selection? How do you select? And that's not trivial. Because very often people say, I wasn't part of it, so I don't feel obliged to go along with it. So who makes the selection? And secondly is, what option and policy, what, you know, you always have also to frame, to put boundaries around what you want to discuss and what you don't want to discuss. Do you want to discuss only the contribution of industry, or only the contribution of agriculture, or the contribution of private consumption? And a lot of these groups will say, no, just talk about the other things, not about me. And of course, that is a problem. About the scope, you know, are you going on the community level, on the regional level, on the country level? And what is the space of the time period? Again, you need boundaries. And the second point is just as important, that closure of how do you get to an agreement? Are you voting? Well, the public participation voting doesn't make much sense because it's not a representative body. So you want consensus? How do you reach some kind of agreement about what argument counts as a good argument? We now live in a world, sometimes being characterized as post-factual, that people have arguments that are absurd. How do you know they are absurd? How do you know who's wrong and who's right? How do you do that? So this is closure. So you have to provide formats. That's very important. If you want to do public participation, it's not enough to say, oh, come, everybody who wants, come here, we'll discuss it, and yet we have a consensus. Well, you probably failed to do that. You need to be very deliberate and very careful about how to do the inclusion, who do you want to invite to be part of it, and what is the format to reach closure. And if you have good answers to these two questions, participation will succeed. And I have 30 years of experience in public participation. I've done on many, many public participation projects. And it's a main issue is to say, number one and number two, if we have good answers, then, well, we feel very, very comfortable that this will work out. So these are two major questions. So anytime you do public participation, think about what and who to include and how to reach closure and get a consensus. So, the one process we have been doing a lot is what we call the analytic deliberative approach. That's not an invention by us. Actually, the US National Academy of Science in its 1984 reports had coins of frame, and there's a combination of analytic expertise and deliberative decision. We need those, as I said. We have high complexity. High complexity means we have to get the best science on board because it's not intuitive. Nobody of us has ever seen climate change. You know, we think we've seen it, but you know, we know that it's there and then we see it. Nobody has seen the ozone hole. We have to need science to tell us about it. So science is extremely important specifically for this non-linear tipping point events because our intuition fails. And we need to have very good science because it can be very expensive to have bad science. So we have to have this analytic element. But what to do with the results and how to make that transition work is not a question of science. That's a question of deliberation. Where in a democratic society, all elements have to contribute and need to be taken on board. And that's why it's important to have the characteristics of analytic component. So it's based on evidence, and of course it's sometimes difficult to put that. You have a plurality of evidence here. It's not that easy, but the ambiguity and uncertainty issue. And then we have the deliberative component, which is based on arguments, not on positions and interests. So everybody has an interest, but that will lead us. We need good arguments to go along. The key variables here are fairness, to reach a common good, to be more resilient and to build capacity to make sure that that transformation works. And the crucial factor here is inclusiveness. We have to have all major parties involved and a consensus on rules, closure again, for the closure. So this is the basic idea to have this analytical deliberative approach. That's kind of the generic format that we need specifically to deal with climate change, but also with air pollution and other major environmental problems. These are some of the major requirements of a deliberative approach. First is you need to have a clear mandate and a frame under which this process is being organized. And again, that's something extremely important. Now, in a democracy, the parliament is the one that makes a decision, not any citizen. And that's important to say from the front. So it's not that a parliament says, oh, I don't want to make a decision, I leave it to the citizen to make a decision. Well, then you erode a parliamentary system. The idea is the parliament makes a decision, but the parliament needs input. It needs input from science, but it also needs input from its citizenry. So one time I call them, we have, you know, physical experts or scientific experts. They come from the sciences, but we also need value experts. And value experts are everyone sitting in this room, everyone sitting outside working, everyone living in this country is the value expert. And these value experts can help the parliamentarians first to tell them what their preference and priorities are. And secondly, that they can say, yes, we are willing to go through this transition. We learned that this is very important. We learned that there will be some hardship, but it's worth going through. So there's a two-way thing of public participation. There's a learning process on one hand side, but it's also the legitimizing process for the parliament on the other side. So these two things need to come together. We need to have, but the mandate has to be clear, that's one point, is recommendation. We do a good recommendation or to the parliamentarians so that they can say, okay, we have the backing here of the public. A range of available suitable options. It's very clear and we can say, oh, we want to have, you know, a wonderful, you know, coal industry here, we want to build 4 or 5 coal power plant. At the same time, we want to have clean air. At the same time, we want to have more cars, but they should be cheap, and we don't care about the exhaust, but we want to have clean air. Well, that doesn't go together. So we need to have realistic options. And realistic options are partially driven by the analytic part. So there the scientists can say, no, sorry, this doesn't go together. No, we can't have those. We try to have win-win situations, but there are only some options that we work. We need the willingness of legal decision makers to give practical participation serious attention. It's not that the parliament has no freedom anymore to say yes or no, but they have to have very good arguments to say no. And we put that as an upfront when we do citizen participation for parliament, done this very often. We say to the parliamentarians, well, if you don't want to consider it seriously, don't do it. This is very important. You have to come back to the citizens and tell them, each of them, what you have adopted and what you didn't. And then the willingness of all parties to learn from each other. So if you have just interest groups there, it's really difficult. Because all the interest groups say, oh, I have my interests here and I have to defend it. I can't learn. No, I'm whatever the industry, I'm an NGO, and I'm what, and you know, my members will kill me if I give in. No. Well, then this is not gonna go anywhere. So we have to be very careful that you develop a frame in which learning can happen. And very important also that, you know, don't moralize the other part. This is something that happens very often, that NGOs say, well, industry is bad, industry is the NGOs are bad. Well, you have to come to the table with, you know, a vision that everybody who sits here is worth sitting here and has, you know, a legitimate point of view that we need to take into account. Now, if I hurry up a little bit. This is now the process of participation within risk issues. And one of the things is that I've been asked very often, should we do public participation for any risk issue? And I said, well, we would be totally overwhelmed if we would do that. So we need to make the characterization. Now, there are risk issues which are called simple risks. For example, wearing helmets for driving and riding a bicycle, or, you know, increasing car safety.
Well, everybody through this, it's very clear what to do. It's not complex. It's not uncertain. It's not the biggest. Well, don't do public participation of these issues. Just get the best agency staff together and find the cost, the most cost-effective way to make the risk, you know, accepted. Don't say, well, what? Don't put all your emphasis on this one. The second one is we have high complexity, but very little uncertainty, very little ambiguity. A lot of toxic materials, a lot of health-related issues related to substances are complex, very complex way that they interact with our body. But we understand it. Medical science has given us very good. Toxicologists have told us how it works. Then we need to include the best scientists and researchers to make sure we have the best models available. But, you know, we need what we call epistemic discourse. And you use the expert to find valid, reliable, relevant knowledge about the risk. That's fine. So we don't need the whole citizenry to be part of it. Now, if you get to more uncertainty, that's number three here. This is this one here. That is, we don't know exactly what the consequences are. So genetic engineering may be good example. Or we take other kinds of environmental issues where we're not quite sure about ecotoxicological impacts. So there's a lot of uncertainty even among scientists. They don't know exactly. They know there are some impacts, but they don't know how much they are. Then it's a negotiation between those who benefit from the risk and those who will suffer from the risk. And they have to come to a conclusion saying, you know, how much uncertainty is worth going ahead and going not ahead. So insurance may play a very major role here. So you need to have the affected stakeholders involved here. And the last one is you have high ambiguity in that. So if there is a different interpretation about what it means and what kind of policies are needed, that's where you have also civil society involved. That's where climate change is, actually it's all of those, where you need a full-fledged participatory process. That's why we call it participatory or participative discourse there. So yes, also, participation is a scarce resource. We cannot do participation on everything. So it's important to go through this kind of filter to make sure that you do participation where it's necessary and, you know, and do routine things where routine is reflected. Sometimes that changes over time. Some of these issues move from simple to complex and certain ambiguity. Sometimes they move back, but it's very important to look at. Now, I just point out some attempts to organize the deliberative involvement processes in Europe so you can see that, yes, we are not just on the theoretical part. And actually, I will give you one example of Germany later on in which we were directly involved. And you can see our UK in 2003 had policy juries on climate change policies. Very important element. Policy juries were randomly selected citizens. This is one way of getting the average citizen. You know, this is, the inclusion was that all citizens had the same chance to be drawn into the participatory process. So this was a random way of doing it. And they met for 3 weekends, and the policy jurists had to do big priorities on climate change policies, and that was given to the prime minister. Switzerland had done focus group on climate change policies and recommendations for Switzerland, again, something that they had done. This was 2009. And the focus groups really, you know, these are, and focus groups different, they're non-randomly selected. They selected specific groups like mothers with a lot of small children or retired people or so people who are very vulnerable to climate change or to air pollution. And they had to see what kind of policies they would like their governments to do. So this was another attempt. I talk about Germany in a second because we were involved in this. Denmark had done so-called consensus conferences, a different format. A consensus conference is a very interesting format if you have a fairly homogeneous society. They select something like 12 to 16 people, very few, but they become a jury. And then all the scientists and all the political advocates come there and tell them what they believe will be done. In the end, those 12, just like judges, make a decision. It's an interesting model. It's been invented in Denmark and has been used in different countries. It works quite well if you don't have too much heterogeneity. So if you have too much heterogeneity, like in Germany, it didn't work.
Wait, what did you say? 12? Well, for 80 million? No. That's not representative. And Europe, we also were involved in this citizen panel of future rural areas. It was also climate change, but there was an emphasis on agriculture, change of agriculture. That is one of the ones where in all of Europe, all 37 European countries were involved. There were citizen groups in all of them. Then they voted for delegates, and then, of course, in the end, they all met in Brussels and gave their recommendation to the European Parliament. Now, I want to briefly to go, this is a BICO, and that's one that basically, when I was still in Stuttgart, so we were asked by the state government to come up with a climate protection plan. And that climate protection plan was supposed to be supported by citizen participation. And we had three different approaches to this. You can see it here. We had first, random selection. There were 100 citizens of the state that were selected by just a random process. In Germany, everybody's registered. So we went through the register, took every 10,000 personalities. The second one, we had an online application, which was basically an application that people could say, yes, you want to be part of it. We, or activists, or whoever wanted to. So we had advertisements in newspapers, but also on computers, to tell people, look, if you want to be part of that plan, you can volunteer. So we had two different kinds of application and random selection. And thirdly, we had online participation with citizens that has the opportunity to submit their views through the internet. And we had something like 10,000 citizens that were part of that. And then we also had what we called civil tables. These were the usual stakeholders. So there were four different stakeholders, were industry, NGOs. And we had 22 of these tables all over the state. So each region was represented. And then basically it was, we had, then they were had different topics on the topic of power supply, topic of consumption, household, industry changes, traffic, trade industry and services, agriculture, forestry, energy, and public sector. So those were the elements there, and they were asked, you know, what should we do in order to protect our climate in these areas? And when we called them reflection sessions were, they had three, or sometimes and the civil table, even four weekends that they met. And we had an analytic process ahead of it. The analytic process was we had asked, the Delphi of experts to design measures for climate protection. They came up with 187, so quite a few. And to also tell the citizens what are the likely consequences of triple cost effects. So what would they cost, what would they mean to them, and what is the likely effect? So this was the input to all of this. And then we had this deliberation phase, and we called them reflection sessions. Some of these kind of different round tables met together. Some of them, of course, they met all separately. In the end, we had delegates from all of them meeting. And this was a very interesting experience for me, because I was the moderator of this last session. And so we had people from, you know, the usual stakeholders. They all came as tidy suits. We had the ordinary people that came just with t-shirts, and we had the nerds from the online participation. They all came, you know, one had a tie with a motherboard on top of it, which was, you know, typical computer nerd. And the computer nerds were all below 30. All the stakeholder groups mostly were about 50. So they were very heterogeneous, and it was not easy, you know, I've been in the business for many, many years, to get them together. But it was very productive. It was very productive. And we got into something like 12 to 15 recommendations of all the groups that were there, all the stakeholders, all the citizens, all the nerds agreed that this is something they want to do. And we gave them to the German Parliament. They had 6 months to digest them. So we, and then they had to come back with a report, which they did. And the report said, this is what we can do. This is for legal reasons. Can't do. Oh, sorry, we would like to, but it's not possible. This is where we put priorities. It matches most of your priorities. And the plan was enacted last year. So, and there was no big protest. I don't think there was anybody who was saying, well, this is, a, you know, even the opposition. Normally in parliament, you have an opposition that says every no to everything. But this time, the opposition was pretty, you know, low in voice. So, in a sense, this process of having everyone contributing was a major element in making, in a sense, two things, making it valid. So the measures of really doing what they're supposed to do, but also doing it legitimate. So it legitimizes a policy that otherwise would have probably been given a lot of rise to a lot of public opposition or even protest. Now, let me go, this is working too much. Let me go to my conclusions. I think that we have problems in handling systemic risks. A risk like climate change is a systemic risk because it penetrates all various areas of life and it can really threaten the functionality of systems. So, and we have difficulties there. We have plural values and knowledge claims. So there are still people who deny that climate change is happening. We have different values. Some people say it's higher my agenda, others say it's really lower my agenda. We have some typical fallacies, a common pool, as that's a common dilemma. We have overconfidence, and just partially optimizing doesn't help. We have little success in addressing the systemic risk so far. Paris may be a sign of hope. There's a failure of intuition when we face high complexity. And there's a failure of trial and error as a learning strategy. And all of these systemic risks are highly socially amplified, attenuated. So they give rise to a lot of public debate and sometimes acrimony. And so they're attached to this kind of risk communication, which is not easy. And that means that a lot of these risks are politicized or polarized. And that we don't get anywhere, and even sometimes we have political paralysis. But so stakeholder involvement, as I said, is a way to validate the policy, but also to legitimize. So the two functions are extremely important. And the requirement there, inclusion, is that we need to have a fair representation of everyone. And in the BECO that I gave you a little review of that, we tried randomly selected citizens as everyone, the stakeholders who have organized interest in it. We had the volunteers, people who wanted to be part of this, and we had the internet society. So we tried to include quite a bit in this. Closure, a fair competition of argument to make sure that they can really deliberate, reflect on this. Legitimacy, it has to be integrated in due political process, a part of the parliamentary voting system. And we need a process that's effective, that really does what it promises, and needs to be efficient too. And we can't spend millions of dollars on this. And an analytical model for risk governance is learning by analytical background knowledge. So we need to know what an analytic kind of insights we get. We cannot ignore the insight for science. That's just not a good policy. Or we need to think specifically about equity because the distribution of policies is a major element now in a political debate. So distributive justice is extremely important. Self-efficacy, participation, decision-making process brings people up to be more self-aware and also increases self-efficacy. And it also adds to identity. Of course, we have new models of ownership and control. One thing that I might add in terms of renewable energy, well, protest against wind farms really decrease when we gave people in the community ownership over the wind. So that was a major element there. So if a power company comes in and says, this is a windmill, I put it right in front of the house, and you take it or you leave. Well, people are not going to like that. If you say, well, this is a windmill here, and you're all part of the owner, anytime that windmill turns around, you have 3 cents on your account. Well, you like it. And that's a very important element. And so now we have something like 7,000 windmill owners in Germany, ownership companies, no, like much more, more than 30,000, that own the facility. That makes a lot of difference, you know, in terms of social identity. So those are the kind of requirements. And I think I would like to end with a quote by Bertrand Russell. He said, well, man desires is not knowledge, but certainty. People want to have certainty. So, you know, transition processes gives you a lot of uncertainty. There's not quite sure where to go, how to go. And I think, you know, yeah, that's true, but the world is different. So we can say policymakers cannot reduce it. It's not possible. So you live in an uncertain world. But they can help all of us to develop coping mechanisms to deal prudently with the necessary uncertainty that is required for societies to progress. Thank you very much.
Very appreciate that Professor Obin gave a very wonderful speech. 那 Obin 教授其实他今天主要的一个论点哈，那各位可以看到，我帮大家稍微 summarize 一下哈，就学理上他讲他谈了什么叫风险哈，什么叫 risk， 那怎么样进行风险治理，那所以在学理上的风险治理里边，他特别刚刚各位看到有两张图嘛，那就是它的核心就是风险。好，那第三个部分，他来跟我们讲有关气候变迁相关的公民参与的部分。好，那在第一个部分，在风险里边，在欧明顿教授他也提到有几个层级。好，第一个叫 simple risk， 好，就最简单的，好，比如说交通啊，骑 bike 啊，好，交通会产生的风险。好，大家每天出门都有。第二个层级是 complex risk。复杂性，那复杂性比如说health related risk， 比如说吃槟榔会得口腔癌，这个在流行病学上面可能就是因果会比较清楚一点，但是它已经进入一定的复杂性了。那第三个层次的风险叫 uncertain risk， 就风险越来越科学上不确定性，那也包含社会的不确定性，比如说这个 nuclear power 它的风险到底它的风险不确定，那譬如说 PM2.5， 比如说 GMO 基因改造食品，或是开始有一些气候的降雨，这些科学上我们现在都慢慢越来越难以用一个单一的因果的科学证据来做决策。那它也慢慢的进入到了第四个层次，就是 ambiguity， 就是社会的模糊跟价值，就是社会价值部分。这部分我想稍微跟各位解释一下，就是事实上我们在做很多的行动跟决策的时候，它除了科学上证据现在会越来越受到挑战之外，比如说建立的城市，另外一个就是社会的价值、社会的选择。那社会的价值、社会的选择包括stem cell 干细胞的研究，或是复制人，我们应该不应该复制胚胎，那基因改造产品也是在这个城市上面。那今天谈的气候变迁，政府做的任何的决策或是我们公民做的任何的行动，其实也会牵涉到社会价值的选择。那台湾过去在这一两年最大的一个类似这样的一个例子，我讲就鼎新的一个油这个厂商用这个越南大溪的油池，它是收水油，可能一次收水油来精炼变成一个食用油，结果通过我们卫生部的酸价检定，通过国家标准的检定，那这个在科学上被检测，它可能对人体不一定有危害但是你看林杰良或是现在严中海医师，他们就想说，哎，有其他毒性可能没有被检测出来，所以他在科学上就有争议，科学有安全问题。那他在社会价值上是模糊的，是有争议的。说我们一般人怎么会容许一个厂商拿收水油经过经验以后，给我们吃，所以科学上他可能会经过检验，但是他在社会价值上是不容许。那在气候变迁也是一样的，比如说我们是不是容许更多的这个燃煤，或是我们更多使用一些这个核能，但是我们现在台湾没有办法解决核废料的问题， 或是核能可能本身有一些科学上的风险，这个大家见解不一，所以社会会有争议。所以一个公共政策的价值，公共政策的决策跟公共政策的选择，可能需要更多的沟通，更多的stakeholder， 就是欧明仁教授刚刚讲的，最后再谈沟通的部分。所以到了第三个最后，他在谈 climate change 这个 public participation， 我想这一个部分是世界各国都在进行的。那我们台湾从2003年，我们社会系一些教授也开始引进这个所谓的刚刚各位可以看到丹麦的所谓 consensus conference， 那巴黎国敏教授、陈龙仁教授，那后来林子伦教授在现场，杜文林教授，他们现在都在努力这个协助政府做公民参与的各种问题。那所以台湾其实我们已经引发十多年的公民参与的议题，那我们也很多的变种，就在台湾我们有很多的实验。所以就是我想今天大家来参与这个，就是像这张图，这个 scenario 比较少一点啦，就是说 I please I decide。 今天我想来现场参与的一个每一个同仁，我想大家都有这样的一个想法，我们可能要从一个旧的典范的世界，一个 energy intensive industry， 台湾过去因为急速发展破坏环境，那我们现在希望有更多的蓝天的 scenario， 更多的 clean air、clean energy 跟 clean industry、跟所谓的循环经济的这一块、我们在海报这边是多一点、所以这边是少一点、所以大家尽量把它拉好，各位注意看、我们年轻的同仁这个地方、有一个 pregnant woman、有一个怀孕的太太、小朋友、那工人、那有一个、这个戴面罩的这个、这个先生、大家一起在拉、那今天来现场，我想大家都是一起用力在拉、把我们的 scenario 搭得、更健康更好、所以我们今天其实无论是上午或下午、那待会上午就是那个东明的吴志新长、来给我们做一个语谈、那洪生亮副秘书长、那我们下午其实会谈到公民科学、citizen science、然后我们另外一个国外学者Oettinger、他下午也会来跟大家谈的。那我们现场有这个徐武龙先生、他们就是在进行这个有关 PM2.5 环境监测的、公民自我提出科学证据的。所以我们台湾其实在某一个部分里面我们还是蛮 progressive 在进步的、但是现在是说怎么将这样的一个 public environment、整个公民的参与真正的投入到、政治的决定、政策的决定、我想这个台湾还需要一些努力、因为台湾过去的政治决策、大部分是属于比较专家决定、现在慢慢在移动，所以这个过程怎么样慢慢的拉过来、那这里拉、可能要更多人一起来拉、所以这个我想是非常重要的一个部分。好，那